Akkermans, and this is Smart Asset Management Lecture 8, Section 5, Additive Manufacturing of Spare Parts. Now, in this Lecture 8 on design for maintenance, additive manufacturing is probably something like a designer's dream. There is almost unlimited freedom. You can design whatever you want. The computer just prints out your design. You don't have to think about how can we manufacture this. Because additive manufacturing is really a collection of technologies in which a design of a tool, of a component is done layer by layer, as opposed to traditional technologies, where basically it's a material subtraction through which a tool or a component is built. And that offers many advantages. Because it's a generic printer, there is no setup cost. You don't need specialized tools, and that makes it possible to print all over in the world, I suppose, and very small series too. The opportunities of this that you don't have from the outside to subtract materials makes it also possible to take out far more material in cubic centimeters than you would normally do. So that allows for great reductions indeed. It's possible to do this both on plastic and on metal, the plastic products through techniques like fused deposition modeling and stereolithography. They've been around for a while. Metal is relatively new. Their power bed fusion is the dominant technology nowadays. It's also much more expensive, the metal production method, but of course also more powerful because many things in the world, certainly in the case of technical assets, are made from metal. So here are just two examples I grabbed from the internet, an example from Streparava and from JKN, where you see that the same function can be performed by a component that looks quite similar, broadly speaking, but if you look closer, then you see that everywhere where there's no material needed, it's not there. In the case of this hydraulic block, that leads to some 80% weight reduction. So pretty spectacular stuff, and indeed a designer's dream. But also additive manufacturing is also a logistician's dream, especially in the context of spare parts, because you don't need any storage or transport there. Spare parts for technical assets are quite challenging for logisticians. Because they typically have a very wide distribution. Everything that's in a machine or in a piece of equipment can break down. You need some spare parts for it. But each of them usually has a very low likelihood of breaking down. So the demand for spare parts is very uncertain. And you don't want to make just one of them as an OEM. You want to make a series of them, which means that you're stuck with stock. You have to have these inventory levels. And because the installed base is usually so geographical dispersed, you can't have one single central inventory. There have to be more local inventory points by which you have less opportunity of pooling of that uncertain demand over many customers. And that's a pain. Wouldn't it just be great if you had additive manufacturing and next to every installed piece of equipment, you would have this 3D printer, and that can print the part, the spare part, on demand. Yeah, it would be great in theory, but how then? So it was time for a promising researcher to figure it all out. Here he is. Here is Bram Westerveld, the proud winner of the 2019 WCM PhD Thesis Research Award with his thesis, Design and Control of Capital Goods Service Supply Chains with Additive Manufacturing, from my alma mater, TU Eindhoven. So the coming slides are all from Bram's thesis. Actually, he looked at four different settings of a supply chain for spare parts with additive manufacturing. And although his thesis contains an obscene number of mathematical equations, there are still some readable parts to it, and I extracted those for your pleasure. So here's the first study he did. Is it really often from the design perspective cheaper to design something in additive manufacturing than regular manufacturing. And he took a case where, or at least an industry, where weight reduction is really important, such as the aerospace industry. So this component is an aileron bracket. It sits at the tips of wings, in this case of a business jet, and it prevents some roll in there, prevents some extra stiffness. The designers of the company that he worked with made a tool, designed a tool by additive with additive manufacturing of titanium, which in itself is a bit heavier than aluminium, but has also other good properties. So in the end, this, because there are fewer cubic centimeters of material needed, it's still lighter, some lousy 80 grams. But that means for one, because of the fuel cost, for one airplane in 1 year of normal use, it means almost 200 euros of fuel cost saved. If you then have 170 airplanes, then and you get to a serious cost saving. However, if you then put that against the production costs, which are more than double of the through additive manufacturing than through regular production, then still regular production wins. And this break-even point, where it doesn't matter if you do it with additive manufacturing or with regular manufacturing, is not reached. It will be different if you take a Niveron example. Take a Boeing 767, which has 1,100 planes out there and which travels more miles. Then yes, additive manufacturing will be cheaper. But in general, the conclusion has to be that just these benefits alone allow for only very small, the deficits, shortcomings of the additive manufacturing component compared to regular manufacturing. The production cost shouldn't be much higher, and the reliability should certainly also not be much higher. So from this perspective, from just a design perspective, the primary driving force is probably still for additive manufacturing, the increased design freedom. Now, let's take some special cases. Let's put those, look at spare parts at very remote locations. Because if the more remote it becomes, the bigger the pain for the spare parts supply chain, you'd say. Well, a pretty extreme example is when the Royal Netherlands Army is, for instance, working in faraway regions like Mali, as the case is here. Then those military logistics have even much more restrictions. So the operating conditions are often difficult. So that means there's even a greater uncertainty in spare parts demand. And so you would need higher spare part levels because everything can break down in the desert or someplace. But the storage place, the space there is limited and costly. And getting stuff there may also be very difficult. By the way, also the storage requirements may be very high because of corrosion or because of dust or whatever. It is really a pain to even have spare parts there. And if you need spare parts transmitted to that location, well, it's going to be difficult because you really need a military convoy to get it there. These are unsafe areas, desert, very hostile. So it has to be combined with other shipments such as food and fuel. So that's really a painful exercise. And here you see just a simple transport supply chain there. You've got the tiny Netherlands with a very pleasant climate and good infrastructure. So getting spare parts from the three locations that the Royal Dutch Army has for these in these cases to the airport, military airport at Eindhoven, that's probably doable. Then you get to the capital in Mali, and from there you have to put it on transport to the main operating base, the MOB. So that's already quite a lot more complex. How about printing at the MOB? Now, some numbers, and if you want numbers, then read lots of numbers at least, and read Bram's thesis. So we talk about some military equipment, some Fennec and some MBs in Mali. They're replenished every 7 days. There are back orders and spare parts costs for all of them. The inventory holding costs are basically 100% of the regular unit order cost for all these reasons mentioned before. And printing it locally leads to an inferior product. It may have a lifetime of just some 10% of the regular counterpart. But 10%, if that's 1 or 2 or 3 years, it may just be what you need in this location compared to the other situation of all this that is the shipment across the globe. And the results of this are much better than the of additive manufacturing, much better if you compare that to more spare parts. We talk about a downtime reduction of 92%, of more than half of the cost savings. This table contains some an alternative policy, expediting. That was the example of getting something to an aircraft carrier somewhere in the middle of the ocean through expediting or local 3D printing. And expediting gets you some of the downtime reduction, but it doesn't get you any of this cost savings because it's so expensive. Now, doing both the expediting and printing, nice, interestingly, is then you can see similar numbers there. Because in any of the cases that Bram investigated, always the printing was better than the expediting. So the expediting, in effect, if you use both, then in practice you only use the printing. So that is a very good policy indeed. If the research question is how should you operate it, well, have a general purpose printer located, even though they produce parts of much lower quality than the regular ones, you can use them as temporary solutions. And the on-site printing leads to large cost savings because there's lower inventory reduction, there's higher asset availability, and so it effectively increases the Army's ability to operate in remote locations. Now, these results extend to many other organizations that operate in remote locations, such as in the mining as in the offshore industry. So this has a much broader impact, this study. And that's just the second study. Here's the third one, age-based preventive maintenance. So we have these capital goods, and you can either print them or the spare parts, or you can replace them more well ahead in advance. The printing hub here acts as a backup option that protects prolonged downtime in case a regular part falls prior to the preventive maintenance. Now, Bram considers two different policies, one in which the printed part are used until the regular part arrives, or one in which also the printed parts have a preventive maintenance threshold. Doesn't really matter. But if you compare that to a benchmark policy where you have only all the time one part in stock for all these spare parts, then yes, on-demand printing is cheaper, especially of course when the holding costs are high. So that's a pretty theoretical study, I suppose. Here is a one which is always so theoretical, but which more surprising findings, I think, which is the idea of IP licensing. So IP, intellectual property, if you license that, it's a pretty normal way of working in software industry, etc. But the idea here is that you license it and the 3D spare parts are printed by the organization that actually gets the license and uses the part. Now, that helps. IP licensing is known in the context where one innovator can then capture the whole market almost. But if you look at from the additive manufacturing perspective, then you have a fixed fee and a unit fee, and buyers can then choose either the license or choose to or be supplied by the traditional sales channel. And the OEM then has the contract design choice. How high is my fixed fee? How high is my unit fee? How high is the conventional fee? And if you look at that, then you see that that this can have massive effects in some markets, because those local 3D printing facilities, they can even replace central mass manufacturing policy. So just visualize, this is the normal way. Now here, the only thing is that the OEM no longer supplies the part to the end user, but just the design, and the end user prints the design herself in a local print service. This is one visualization of results where Bram set out a whole series of scenarios depending on what the size is of the buyers versus to each other. He considered only two buyers, but that captures the whole idea of the skewedness of the market, I suppose, and the unit royalty fee, so compared to the total fee in general. And then the different colors show you different, different regions actually. There is a region where the buyers are almost the same size, and the costs of the royalty are really high. Then yes, only in this narrow area, none of them will accept the license, and all of them, the whole market will continue to work in the traditional way. But the biggest size is really this decentralized mixed, where both, the whole market actually accepts the IP license contract. That's by far the most common structure. And even in here, they will do the printing, but just the contract structure will be different. So if this really starts working well, then that may have a massive impact on supply chain structures in the future indeed. And we'll see how that plays out in practice, but for now, additive manufacturing seems to be a very promising new addition to the notion of design in the context of asset management.